Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Contemplative Tarot, A Christian Guide to the Cards by Brittany Muller. Foreword by Carl McColeman. Narrated by Kira Fixx. Foreword by Carl McColeman.
Everyone knows social media is a mixed bag. We are painfully aware of how online networking services contribute to political polarization or have provided a channel for the spread of misinformation and conspiracy theories. But there are real blessings and benefits associated with social media as well. From reconnecting with a long-lost friend from second grade to finding a group of people who share exactly your tastes and interests in art or fashion or whatever. Social media has also helped people with unique or distinctive spiritual values or practices to find one another. And so I felt such a rush of excitement when I first stumbled across Brittany Muller's Instagram feed, where she combines beautiful photography, including images from the tarot, with insightful meditations on the cards, all written from a clear Christian perspective. Many Christians might wonder, why bother with the tarot? And tarot enthusiasts might reply, why bother with Christianity? But as Brittany Muller and her many thousands of followers can attest, there are plenty of us who find meaningful connections between our faith and the strange and wondrous symbolism found in the cards. Take, for example, the Temperance card, 14 in the major arcana. This fascinating image presents an angel, red wings spread wide, an aura radiating around the being's blonde hair. Holding two large chalices, the angel is pouring water or some other fluid from one to the other. But it's pouring at a 45-degree angle, a physical impossibility. Likewise, the angel is standing with one foot on a stone and the other slightly submerged in a pool of water. But the angel's weight appears to be borne by the foot in the water. Again, beyond the laws of ordinary physics. Surrounded by irises and a pathway leading to distant mountains before the setting sun, the entire scene feels like something from a dream. Christians recognize temperance as a fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 through 23. From a Greek word that means self-restraint or self-control. It implies mastery or power over the self. But it also brings to mind the word temperature, which signifies the measurement of heat or cold, particularly in the human body. We take someone's temperature when trying to determine if they are sick or well. So in a matter of minutes, this dreamy angel has encouraged me to consider how taking the measure of what is going on inside of me can be an important way of assessing my wellness, or lack thereof. Which brings me to why I, as a Christian, continue to study and appreciate the vivid and marvelous imagery of the tarot. It's a tool for getting to know my interior life, just like a thermometer or a stethoscope can aid a doctor in diagnosing, knowing, what's going on in my body. The images of the tarot tell a story. This has been called the Fool's Journey from the card enigmatically numbered 0 in the Major Arcana. I mentioned the pathway behind the Angel of Temperance. It is one of many paths, roads, and other passages found in the 78 images of a modern tarot deck. From the Eight of Cups to the Six of Swords to the Chariot in the Major Arcana, numerous tarot images evoke a sense of being on the move. I suppose it is a cliché to say life is a journey, but clichés exist because they point to something commonly experienced. We experience life as a journey because there is movement, in time, if not through space. I am not the same person I was a decade or two ago, and neither are you. Not only have nearly all the cells of our bodies changed entirely, but our very sense of self has adapted to new experiences, insights, and understandings. You cannot step into the same river twice applies as much to you as it does to the river. Yet while there might be a kind of temporal uniformity to the journey of life, we can expect to be a child for our first 12 years, an adolescent for the next 6, a young adult for a decade or two after that, and so forth. There is also great variety. We all mature at different rates, age at our own pace, experience growth or decline, self-improvement or self-neglect in rhythms uniquely our own. The insights that enlightened you in college might remain hidden from me until I am elderly. So we are all on a journey, but what a rich, complex, and multivalent journey that is. The 78 images of the tarot seem to tell some sort of silent story, an almost mythic tale of its own. In this sense, the fool is like Joseph Campbell's hero with 1,000 faces. And the tarot itself is like Gandalf or Obi-Wan Kenobi ushering Bilbo Baggins or Luke Skywalker into their own strange and life-changing adventures. But while we may watch Star Wars or read The Fellowship of the Ring to be entertained, the journey of the hero asks more of us. We are invited to bring our own journey into conversation with the strange and mystifying symbols we find in this deck of cards. Christian interpreters of the tarot, from Valentin Tomberg and Mark Patrick Hederman to Brittany Muller, typically either ignore or reject the card's reputed ability to predict the future. Tarot for reflection, not divination, is how Brittany so succinctly puts it on her Instagram page. There is a very simple reason for this. Christians don't believe in fate. "The truth will set you free," promised Jesus, and we take him at his word. If I am free, then I do not have to break out in a sweat if the Tower card or the Ten of Swords shows up in a tarot spread. Which brings us back to the question of why bother with the cards at all. Brittany's distinction between divination and reflection is the clue to answer that question. The 78 images in the tarot are distinctive, unusual, ethereal, sometimes strangely beautiful, and at other times may seem unsettling or even disturbing. But if you've taken an honest look deep within yourself lately, you probably can recognize that there is remarkable beauty and unsettling stuff within your own heart, too. The journey of the fool through the weird landscape of the tarot offers us a reflection on our own journeys, no matter how predictable or chaotic they might be. And because the tarot offers us images rather than lots of words, it bypasses the watchful dragons of the rational thinking mind and appeals directly to the hidden places deep in our subconscious. This brings us back to the 45-degree angle pouring of the Temperance card, which is one of several clues in the tarot that suggest these images are invitations into a dreamscape. Truly, the tarot is reminiscent of a dream, a long, complex, and wondrously mystical dream. From swords to cups, knights to castles, angels to flowers, the images in the cards seem sublime, meditative, otherworldly. Trying to interpret these cards can seem as daunting as trying to make sense of the uncanny logic and random reverie that visits you or me or anyone while sleeping. The best dream interpreters will encourage you to view your dream as a kind of deeply symbolic story you are telling yourself. There is no one right way to interpret the dream, as if symbols in our subconscious could only have one fixed meaning. But by having a kind of conversation with your dream, it can offer you surprising insights into the hidden places within your own psyche. The tarot can function similarly. A reflection, not of some immutable truth out there, but of the liberating truth of the spirit found poured into your very heart. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Why bother with the tarot? Because the cards invite us into a story, a journey, a dream, a mystery. The fool, of course, is simply an alter ego for your or my or anyone's self. As Christians, this need not embarrass us. After all, St. Paul invites us to be fools for Christ's sake. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10. Jesus instructed us to become like little children. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3. Therefore inviting us to be silly, to play, to wonder, and to laugh like the smallest ones among us. It's no accident that tarot originally was a game. One more thing to say about Brittany Muller's wise advice. When we approach the tarot for reflection, it invites us to encounter these 78 images through the practice of meditation and contemplation. It's no accident that the most renowned Christian commentary on the major arcana is titled Meditations on the Tarot. That book is densely philosophical, deeply esoteric, and difficult to read, but its basic message is sound: that these images can be profitably used by Christians for prayer and spiritual practice, leading to interior transformation. Meditation, reflecting on spiritual truth, and contemplation, resting silently in the love of God, are core Christian practices, dimensions of prayer, and means for spiritual nurture. They are also the doorways to the mystical life, where union with Christ is more than just a theological principle, but a lived reality. The Jesuit theologian Karl Rahner famously said half a century ago that the Christian of the future will be a mystic or will not exist. Is Rahner's future our present? Certainly many people in our time have abandoned the liberating wisdom of Jesus Christ. Perhaps we cannot blame them for this, since the Christian church, institutionally speaking, has often been hostile to mysticism, just like the church has been unfriendly to the tarot. Perhaps there is a link between these tendencies of the church to be overly cautious, to the point, unfortunately, of quenching the spirit. Many Christians reject that tarot because of its association with fortune-telling. Likewise, mysticism gets denounced for a variety of reasons. It is too pagan, too pantheistic, too Eastern, too New Agey, too anti-authoritarian. All of these criticisms are patently unfair. I hope this book can not only help Christians discover a spiritually sound and helpful approach to the cards, but in doing so also contribute to the needed restoration of mystical spirituality within Christianity as well. In fact, Christianity has its own deeply rooted mystical tradition, and given the amount of Christian imagery found in classical tarot decks, like the Waite-Smith deck, it's reasonable to assume that tarot artists and commentators down the generations have recognized the deep affinity between the fool's journey and the mysteries of faith that are encoded in the teachings of the great Christian mystics. All this leads back to the question I imagined some tarot enthusiasts might ask. Why should those interested in tarot bother with Christianity? Without getting too lost in the details of Christian theology, I'll just say this. Christianity, at least Christian mystical spirituality, offers a meaningful vision of a God who is love. Pure, boundless, joyous love. And this vision invites us into a life transfigured by that divine love. Christianity invites us into a relationship with that God through Jesus and through the Holy Spirit, through whom the love of God is poured into our hearts. We live in what has been called the post-Christian age, so not everyone who picks up this book will identify as a Christian. Just as not everyone who listens to this book may have any prior knowledge of tarot. I think a lasting gift of this book will be how Brittany Muller plays matchmaker, introducing us to both the insights of the tarot and the splendor of Christian spirituality, and how they work together for anyone seeking that deep inner reflection that comes from the alchemical union of these two different yet related wisdom traditions. If you are new to either Christianity or the tarot, please set aside any preconceived notions that you might have and approach the insights that follow with an open mind. The great Christian mystic, Julian of Norwich, said, "The fullness of joy is to behold God in all." If we take this seriously, and I do, then we can behold God within us, embedded in our very souls, as we can also find God in a tool for soul exploration like the tarot. And we can meet God in the inner dialogue that emerges when we allow the images of the tarot to speak to our soul, and vice versa. I hope as you listen to Brittany Muller's thoughtful words, you won't just look for knowledge about the cards. look for how the tarot invites you beyond itself, into the heart of divine love. And then take the journey into the dream and into the mystery. Introduction. Saint Augustine famously wrote, in the exquisitely personal voice of the Confessions of Saint Augustine, "Thou hast made us for thyself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it finds its rest in thee." My own life makes the most sense to me when I view it through the lens of this same restless search. Here are the things that have pushed me away from God. Here are the things that have led me back to God. The things that push me away from God, they always seem easy and comfortable at first, but they leave me dissatisfied and restless. The things that pull me toward God, they are often difficult and demand more of me than I would like to give, but they bring peace with them too. My whole life is an effort to remain keenly aware of the push and pull so as to find the resting place. It is an old struggle. Augustine wrote those words at the turn of the 5th century. It is a common struggle, too. The parable of the prodigal son is enduringly popular because so many of us feel compelled to live it for ourselves. But as Augustine says, we are made for God, and we can find rest. I grew up in a Christian home. We were church-going, but not settled about it. And I spent my young childhood hopping in and out of different Protestant denominations, Presbyterian, Methodist, Southern Baptist. I saw spiritual restlessness firsthand. When I was 13, our family converted to Catholicism. In that steady tradition, my parents' restlessness ceased abruptly, and I picked up on their contentment. I spent my teenage years as a devout Catholic, regularly going to daily mass, spending time at adoration, reading theology for fun, acquiring a taste for God. It was a beautiful, fledgling faith. But it's easy to be virtuous in the absence of temptation, and it's easy to have faith when nothing ever tests it. I became an adult, and I left home, and, embarrassingly, doubts pushed in almost immediately. Also, embarrassingly, the doubts weren't even of an interesting variety. They were the same well-worn questions of faith that people have wrestled with for thousands of years. I didn't know how to be Catholic and also have doubts, and I didn't know how to be a Christian without being Catholic, and so I left everything behind. I stopped reading Aquinas and Anselm and Augustine. I stopped going to church. I stopped praying. I simply disengaged from the questions I could not answer, distancing myself from anything having to do with religion, and instead calling myself a hopeful agnostic. The freedom was thrilling at first. It always is. I told myself that I could do what I wanted to do and believe what I wanted to believe and go where I wanted to go. But Christianity had been the thing around which my whole life was ordered, and I felt the absence of its gravity. I felt it particularly in my early 20s as I moved through the big life changes of marriage and children. By the age of 25, I was living in Austin, Texas with my husband, busy with law school, and our 2 sons under 2, busy with keeping us awake at night. I was a stay-at-home mom, and I was struggling with the intensity of motherhood and the particular invisibility that often accompanies that kind of caretaking. I wanted something to anchor me, to order my days, to provide a rhythm to my life, to bring me back to myself. Where does one then turn when, before, one has always turned to prayer? Austin has a reputation for being a witchy kind of place, and I found that reputation to be true. Most everyone I met was trying to cultivate some sort of personal spiritual meaning. I had friends who collected crystals, friends who practiced astrology, friends who went on Sunday morning hikes and called it church. I also had friends who played around with tarot cards. Captivated by the images, I bought a Waitsmith deck for myself. I bought it because I was bored and restless. I bought it because I missed the intentionality of prayer. I bought it because I, too, was trying to cultivate meaning. Tarot scratched my itch for the ritual of religion, and I quickly fell in love with how it made me feel seen. I never used it for divination because I've never believed in divination, but I loved creating a quiet space to shuffle cards and pull cards and sit with them. I loved getting to know characters like the Fool and the Empress, the Knights and the Queens. I loved registering my ever-changing reaction to these images and seeing myself, good and bad, reflected in them. Tarot helped me to know myself again. It was also a fine substitute for prayer, until it slowly became no longer the substitute, but the substance. The sneaky thing about tarot is that it is full of surprisingly Christian imagery. Tarot originated in 15th century Italy, and the cards reflect the deeply Christian culture of that particular time and place. During a time in my life when I wanted nothing to do with Christianity, I simply refused to read scripture or attempt prayer or darken the door of a church, I was pulling cards almost every day and using them mostly as journaling prompts. My Catholic upbringing wouldn't allow me to look past the Christian ideas that permeate the tarot. I would pull temperance and write about the presence of that virtue in my life. I would pull the Hierophant and meditate on the joys and sorrows of the institutional church. I would pull the devil and find myself reflecting on the nature of my own particular vices. Confronted with these images over and over again, I felt unable to escape my own sense of spiritual restlessness. Over the course of these years, my tarot practice began to feel less like a writing exercise and more like a prayer. The thing that had always helped me to see myself more clearly started to show me the God-shaped hole in my life. I wish I had a dramatic story to tell about my return to Christianity, but the story holds no drama. I did not simply wake up one day and decide to believe in God again. My return to Christianity was as slow and meandering as my departure was sharp and abrupt. I admitted to myself that I missed religion, that I was restless and unsettled, that my own attempts at being spiritual but not religious were not enough. I quietly, almost furtively, started rereading some of my favorite spiritual writings from my teenage years. Augustine's Confessions, Henri Nouwen's Life of the Beloved, Teresa of Avila's The Interior Castle. Living in Manhattan at the time, I wandered the medieval galleries of the Metropolitan Museum of Art and spent time with the religious art there. I popped into churches while out running errands and didn't tell anyone. I made fumbling attempts at prayer. I cried a lot. I also started attending an Episcopal church in our neighborhood at the request of my husband, who was looking for community after our move to New York City. We found ourselves going back every week, warmly welcomed by the people there. Slowly, almost imperceptibly, the restlessness went out like the tide. This is the point in the story where the listener expects me to write about how I abandoned tarot in the peaceful wake of my return to Christianity. That would be a tidy ending, wouldn't it? Tarot has a bad reputation, after all. I didn't abandon it, though. To be honest, the idea never once crossed my mind. It seemed unthinkable to me because tarot was one of the things that led me back to God. To my mind, tarot and Christianity are a natural pair, even though their marriage seems strange at first, and second and third glance. I integrated tarot seamlessly into my prayer practice, pulling cards with morning prayer and finding connections between the images and scripture. To most everyone's surprise but my own, it fit perfectly. I was excited enough about this connection that I started to share my thoughts publicly, mostly on Instagram. A lot of people didn't like it. Tarot readers were suspicious of organized religion. Christians were suspicious of a practice tinged with the occult. But some people did like it. Enough people, at least, for me to be able to write this book for you. Writing this book has been the greatest pleasure, I have loved being given the challenge of explaining tarot as a coherent theological whole, and I have loved being given the gift of time to dive deeply into theology, time that I haven't had since I was a teenager. In looking for research and inspiration for this book, I drew from the theological sources that most move me: the early church fathers, the medieval mystics, the lives and writings of the saints, and many papal encyclicals. I spent the better part of a year reading Athanasius and Julian of Norwich, biographies on my favorite women saints, and slim volumes by popes on joy and suffering and mercy. Reading this list of theological inspiration, you'll be unsurprised to learn that, while tarot led me back to Christianity, writing a book about tarot led me specifically back to Catholicism. My research had a Catholic bent, and so the book has a natural Catholic bent as well. That being said, I've also tried to keep it as ecumenical as possible. While I read through a lot of specifically Catholic theology in researching this book, I also read through the Bible again. And in writing the book, I tried to draw from biblical common ground whenever I needed a story or a line of poetry or a feeling to illustrate the meaning of a card. In addition, I've used the NRSV translation of the Bible, as it's the translation with which I am most familiar. Writing the Contemplative Tarot has felt like a chance to write about the God whom I adore and the practice that taught me how to adore God again. For me, this book feels less like a how-to guide and more like a collection of 78 little prayers. By that, I mean that these interpretations are my own and are deeply personal to me. I hope they will be helpful to you, but I also hope that you will take them in the spirit in which they are given. They are not the rule of law. In most places, I have tried not to stray too far from the original meanings of the cards, instead teasing out the theological implications of the traditional meanings. But what I tease out of the cards might be different from what you will tease out. Tarot's beauty lies in its ability to be constantly reinterpreted. What I hope, more than anything, is that this book will inspire you to slow down, to remain open to God's still, small voice, and to let the cards help you form your own prayers. 1. A Brief History of Tarot. There are many histories of tarot. Few of them are true. If you want to learn about tarot, you can read about how tarot contains the lost hermetic knowledge of ancient Egypt. You can find intricate theories on tarot's esoteric connection to Kabbalah, that mystical Jewish school of thought. You can listen to arguments that tarot and the I Ching are intimately connected, being the major oracles of the West and East, respectively. You can learn about tarot's origins in Indian Tantra and tarot's origins in Romani culture and tarot's origins in Waldensian teaching. There are as many theories on the beginnings of tarot as there are tarot readers to champion them. But these myths are just that. Elegant myths, never verified by the people who first espouse them, are taken for truth and become part of the culture of tarot. And so the history can appear murky, making tarot seem more mysterious than it is. Appearances are deceiving, though. In truth, in actual verifiable truth, tarot began its life as nothing more than a card game, with no purpose beyond providing entertainment to Italian nobles. This may be a disappointment for those who wish tarot to be more magical than it is, but if we follow the thread of truth, we find that the real history is interesting in its own right. Renaissance Italy was nothing if not Catholic. How could it be anything else? At the time, the Catholic Church was undoubtedly the central institution of Western Christianity, and it was seated in Rome, apart from that brief and embarrassing detour to Avignon in the 14th century. The capital C church was in the Italians' backyard. In many ways, this was a point of pride, and of course, Catholicism was a distinguishable mark of Italian culture. Much of the most famous art of the Italian Renaissance, Michelangelo's Creation of Adam, Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper, Raphael's Sistine Madonna, is religious art. That being said, while this closeness to the church was an inspiring gift, At times, it was an equally inspiring point of revulsion. Sometimes closeness breeds contempt, and anyone who was that close to the institution of Catholicism had a front-row seat to the unsavory sides of the papacy, not always apparent from a distance. While Petrarch was a devout Catholic, he had no problem lambasting the Curia, the administrative institution of the Church. Boccaccio's The Decameron contains stories that gleefully satirize the clergy. Dante's The Divine Comedy famously puts some popes in hell. The point is this. However one felt about religion, it could not be ignored. Good or bad, Christianity was a thing that had to be reckoned with. Renaissance means rebirth and refers to the revival of classical antiquity that occurred first in Italy and then across the rest of Europe in the 15th century. What was being rebirthed during this time was interest in the ancient world. Works by Plato and Aristotle and Homer were brought back via the Italian trade routes that covered the Mediterranean. Scholars searched monastic libraries and found ancient manuscripts. There was a new blooming interest in the Greek and Roman cultures of antiquity, and the thinkers of the Renaissance sought to revive the ideals of these cultures to measure themselves by the standards of the ancient world and to carry on its legacy. One of the intellectual challenges of the Italian Renaissance was figuring out how exactly to do those things. Obviously, much of what was being unearthed about the ancient world had its origins in pagan antiquity, and the people of 15th century Italy self-identified as Christian to a degree that can be difficult for us to fathom today. Everything needed to fit, somehow, into a Christian worldview. This challenge was one of the sparks of the Renaissance. How could the pagan classics of antiquity and the Christian belief of the day be held together? One of the men who wrestled with this challenge was Marsilio Ficino, a Catholic priest and dedicated scholar of Greek philosophy. The first to translate Plato's extant works into Latin, Ficino was deeply immersed in Platonic ideas like immortality of the soul, rewards and punishment after death, and a superior, immaterial world that superintends the earthly world. If that sounds a lot like Christianity to you, you're not alone. Ficino was convinced that there were hidden depths and traditions not considered Christian, Platonism among them, that still aligned with Christian thought, and he worked to make that alignment clear. While Ficino was trying to align pagan and Christian thought in his own philosophical way, the writers of the Renaissance were teasing out their own interpretations. This new acquaintance with classical antiquity familiarized the authors of the Italian Renaissance with allegory, a literary device that writers such as Petrarch and Dante used extensively to advance Christian thought. Dante's comedy is a clear allegory for man's journey to salvation. Petrarch's I Trionfi, triumphs, evokes the Roman ceremony of the triumphal procession, honoring allegorical figures such as love, chastity, death, and time, while showing us the ideal course of a man moving from sin to redemption. Rooted in Christianity and enamored of pagan antiquity, ever trying to marry the two. This was the cultural environment that birthed tarot. The first tarot deck was created sometime in the early 15th century. We do not know exactly who it was created for, but the most likely candidate is Duke Filippo Maria Visconti of Milan. This new tarot deck would have been, in many ways, familiar to an Italian noble like the Duke, created not for divinatory purposes, but for playing a game similar to bridge. It contained the four suits of the regular playing card deck, with which the Italian nobility would have been familiar: cups, batons, coins, and swords. These were pip cards, somewhat prosaic cards, marked only with the small and standard symbols that denoted each card's suit and value. What made the new tarot deck special was the novel addition of a fifth suit consisting of 21 trumps and a fool. These trump cards were originally illustrated, but unlabeled, and while their symbolism and order varied among individual decks, Their Renaissance influence was always clear. The trumps contained allegorical figures that expressed ideas from both Christian thought and classical antiquity. These are the same figures that are familiar to tarot readers today. Death, the fool, the empress, temperance, justice, etc. This is what tarot was from the start. Nothing more than a card game with which Italian nobles could while away idle hours, and nothing less than an allegory for a journey through life. So what happened? How did tarot evolve from an unassuming card game to an esoteric divinatory device? It took a long time for that shift to happen. The game of tarot moved through Europe over the course of several hundred years, but during this time, it remained nothing more than a card game, and not even a particularly widespread one at that. Tarot died out in Italy. It remained fairly popular in France and Switzerland, but not really anywhere else. Eventually, tarot decks became standardized in the form of the Tarot de Marseille, a deck that is still in use today. At this point, however, it was still only a game. Tarot's shift from a simple card game to an occult tool shrouded in mystery happened not gradually, but rather abruptly. And it happened in 19th century France. Napoleon Bonaparte was obsessed with Egypt. In his youth, he had been fascinated by the East, and so, as an adult, he conducted a capricious military campaign in Egypt. The campaign had no real military purpose, but it got him close enough to the East for which he longed. In the true spirit of the Enlightenment of his time, he took a team of scientists and archaeologists with him on this campaign, ensuring that a steady stream of Egyptian artifacts found their way back to France. Because Napoleon was fascinated by Egypt, everyone in France was fascinated by Egypt. This curiosity snowballed into a fanatic infatuation with anything deemed exotic by the French. By the 19th century, many scholars began to seek out similarities between Christianity and other religions, such as Hinduism and Kabbalism. A renewed interest in the occult developed, and spiritual philosophies like Spiritism, Theosophy, Freemasonry, and Martinism thrived. This was the beginning of the French occult revival, and it was in this atmosphere that tarot was transformed from a card game to a divinatory device. Removed from its Renaissance context, tarot became instead a mysterious object that appeared to contain promises of forgotten esoteric lore, rediscovered by people primed to find esoteric knowledge in everything. The Protestant pastor and Freemason Antoine Corre de Gebelin could be said to be the originator of tarot's connection to the occult. He lived in France in the 18th century, and while his interest in the occult predated France's occult revival, he set the stage for what tarot would become. The way Corre de Gebelin told the story, he was once at a party in Paris where he came across some ladies playing the game of tarot. These cards were unusual in Paris, and he was struck by their imagery. Since he had what was, at the time, a precocious interest in the mysteries of ancient Egypt, his immediate thought upon seeing tarot cards was that the symbolism contained the remnants of the lost Book of Thoth, an ancient text supposed to have been written by the Egyptian god of writing and knowledge. With no reliance on either the historical reality of tarot or accurate knowledge of Egyptian hieroglyphics, Corre de Gebelin took a mighty contextual leap and reconstructed tarot history. He made public his theories on tarot in an essay included in his work, Monde Primitif, Analyse de Comparé avec le Monde Moderne. In his hands, tarot lost its significance as a game and became something mysterious and wholly new. Corre de Gebelin's new ideas on tarot later gained currency in Egypt-crazed France, with the help of one man. While Antoine Corre de Gebelin set the stage for the new tarot, it was Eliphas Lévy who brought tarot its full occult potential. Born Alphonse Louis Constant, Lévy originally pursued the Catholic priesthood and, after being ordained a deacon, abandoned the path to the priesthood at the age of 26. At the age of 40, he began to publicly profess a knowledge of the occult and became an esotericist of great renown. He had a reputation as an original thinker and his extensive writings on ceremonial magic attracted attention in 19th century France. Lévy was also interested in the tarot, and he carefully incorporated the cards into his theories on magic. He believed, as Cœur de Gébelin did, that tarot contained within its symbols the secrets of ancient Egypt, and he used the images of the Tarot de Marseille to further his esoteric belief that the Book of Thoth was the origin of all religions. He did not, however, hold in high regard the idea of using tarot as a divinatory device. The use of tarot for divination had been familiar in France since the occultist Jean-Baptiste Alliette published, under the pseudonym Etea, a few small books about divinatory tarot in the late 18th century. Lévy knew of these books and believed that it was possible to use tarot for divination, but he also believed that tarot's most valuable purpose lay in its ability to convey ancient and universal wisdom. As the 19th century drew to a close, there was a trend in France away from the use of tarot as a receptacle for universal wisdom and toward the use of tarot for divination. In response to this divinatory interest, the occultist Pepus published Le Tarot Divinatoire, Clef du Tirage des Cartes et des Sceaux, a tome dedicated entirely to cartomancy. While Pepus himself did not have much respect for cartomancy, believing it to be primarily of interest to women, he had a thorough knowledge of tarot through his analyses of Lévy's work, and was happy to capitalize on its interest. With Pepus's work, tarot's transformation from a simple game to a complicated esoteric device was complete. Oblivious to the Italian origins of tarot, French occultists cemented tarot's place in the halls of the occult, successfully convincing the world that tarot was a mysterious Egyptian source of magical knowledge and a tool for divining the future. It was during the French occult revival that tarot first became associated with esotericism, but interest in tarot didn't stay in France. Victorian England had its own occult revival sometime later, though it took on a different flavor there. The English had their own fascination with Egypt, of course, but they also developed a sort of fanaticism for Celtic culture, sparking the Celtic Revival, which so inspired writers like William Butler Yeats and A.E. Russell. By the 1880s, all manner of religious sects and spiritual groups were popular. The Counter-Enlightenment sparked the development of mystery cults like Freemasonry and Rosicrucianism, Theosophy and Swedenborgianism. Thanks to the new ease of reproducing books and pamphlets, many books on the occult came into wide circulation, including Lévy's writings on tarot. In the midst of all this spiritual renewal, tarot became a part of England's cultural milieu, and its emergence in English culture was helped along by one particular occult society. The Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn was founded in England toward the end of the 19th century. The founders, William Robert Woodman, William Wynne Westcott, and Samuel Little MacGregor Mathers, were Freemasons, and they founded the Golden Dawn in response to a set of documents called the Cipher Manuscript. Though there is much controversy surrounding the documents, among other theories, some believe they were written by Westcott himself in order to lend credence to the subsequently founded Golden Dawn, it is true that they formed the basis of the Golden Dawn's beliefs. The Cipher Manuscript gives an outline of a series of magical initiation rituals, contains information on magical theory, and offers a sort of magical curriculum that encompasses ideas relating to Kabbalism, astrology, alchemy, and tarot. The Golden Dawn's teachings drew from these ideas, connecting many of the esoteric threads of the day. As a result, the Golden Dawn became the crowning glory of England's occult revival. And though the order was small, it never possessed more than 300 members, it had a mighty influence on the development of tarot. It was the Golden Dawn that truly introduced the tarot to England. One of the Golden Dawn's founders, Mathers, wrote the first guide to tarot in England. The Tarot, Its Occult Signification, Use in Fortune-Telling, and Method of Play. He published it in 1888, the same year the Golden Dawn was founded. This guide was really nothing more than a regurgitation of Eliphas Levi's ideas on tarot. But all the same, it established tarot in England as a magical tool and primed England for further ideas on tarot. This priming was useful for the members of the Golden Dawn, because they were busy taking their highly syncretistic system of magic and applying it to tarot, altering the sequence of the trump cards and linking tarot to the various mystical and magical interests of the day. At the time, all of this information was carefully guarded, because the Golden Dawn was exactly that kind of high magic, highly secret society. Of course, this information did not remain hidden. Everything was shrouded in mystery, until it wasn't. The Golden Dawn had many famous members: Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, Charles Williams, Evelyn Underhill, William Butler Yeats, Bram Stoker. It also had one particularly infamous member, Aleister Crowley. Headstrong and astonishingly egotistical, Crowley advanced through the various levels of the Golden Dawn quickly. However, his morals and conduct were offensive to some members of the Golden Dawn, and he was eventually refused further advancement. Crowley retaliated by spilling the occult beans. In 1909, he published his book, Liber 777, which gave to the world the Golden Dawn's secrets on tarot. He also started an occult periodical, The Equinox, in which he divulged garbled versions of the Golden Dawn's teachings. Crowley eventually left England, moving to Sicily and establishing the notorious Abbey of Thelema in 1920. Thelema was the name he gave to the spiritual philosophy he created from a mix of Golden Dawn teachings, yoga, and Eastern and Western mysticism. His teachings on Thelema inspired the later development of Wicca, and the tarot deck he created, the Thoth Tarot, is still in use today. The history of tarot cannot be discussed without mention of Aleister Crowley. He made the Golden Dawn's secrets secret no more, divulging information that had an undeniable influence on modern tarot interpretations. However, the major innovator of tarot during this time was not Crowley, but Arthur Waite, a man less salacious, but more renowned. Arthur Waite was born in Brooklyn and grew up in England. He was raised a Catholic, but also had an interest in the occult. As one might expect, this led to an eventual entrance into the Golden Dawn in 1891. Waite was never on good terms with the founders, though, and was dissatisfied with the Golden Dawn's emphasis on magic and the occult to the exclusion of mysticism. He left the Golden Dawn, rejoined it, became frustrated by the increasingly splintered infighting of the Golden Dawn's twilight days, and found one of the handful of offshoots of the Golden Dawn. This offshoot, the Independent and Rectified Order of RR et AC, disbanded in 1914. In 1915, he formed the Fellowship of the Rosy Cross, an organization that reflected Waite's interests in Rosicrucianism, Freemasonry, and Christian mysticism. Waite was deeply immersed in tarot, and his influence on modern tarot cannot be underestimated. He spoke of the tarot symbolism as reflecting a mystic initiation and as a metaphor for spiritual rebirth. He believed that tarot did not contain occult truths, but rather mystical ones. For Waite, tarot was less about gaining control of esoteric knowledge and more about connection with the spiritual life. Perhaps more than any tarotist since the Italian Renaissance, Waite came closest to sensing the tarot's origins in Christian allegory. What's more, he was deeply immersed in Christian mysticism, and that immersion is evident in the deck he created. In 1909, Waite published his most famous contribution to the history of tarot, a tarot deck he created with the significant help of artist Pamela Coleman Smith. What was special about the Waite-Smith deck was that while the trumps were illustrated, so were the pip cards. What was also special about the deck was that it standardized tarot's imagery. It became the most popular deck in the history of tarot, and almost every deck on the market today follows its templates of imagery and meaning. It is almost always the deck one sees in pop culture images of tarot. It is most often the deck conjured in one's mind when tarot is mentioned. It is arguably the most easily recognizable tarot deck in the world. For those reasons, it is also the deck used in this book. During the occult revivals of France and England, occultists were always in search of the one true tarot. They wanted to purify tarot, to bring it back to what they assumed to be its ancient Egyptian roots. They wanted tarot to unlock the secrets of the universe. They wanted to understand what they believed to be the ancient wisdom contained in tarot's images. These esoteric ideas about tarot began to shift subtly during the New Age movement of the 1970s. The New Age movement, in some ways, was not so different from the occult revival of the 19th century. There was a fanatical interest in exotic spiritualities. It became trendy to cherry-pick spiritual practicism from Buddhism, Hinduism, Native American religions, and others. Things like astrology, crystal healing, and past life regressions came into vogue. It makes sense that tarot would become popular during this time, and it did. However, tarot was not used in quite the same way as it had been used before. The New Age was less focused on ancient universal wisdom and more focused on personal self-actualization. Tarot became less about learning the secrets of the universe and more about learning the secrets of the self. This shift from the universal to the personal was reflected in tarot's appearance. Beginning in the 1970s, there was a new wave of tarot decks on the market, each one suited to a special interest. The New Tarot contains a mix of Egyptian and Tahitian art. The Zoltan Tarot attempts to fit ancient Mayan culture to the 78 cards. The Morgan Greer Tarot has a distinctly witchy feel. There was, and continues to be, a deck for whatever suits one's own spiritual and artistic preferences. There has been a renewed interest in tarot in the last 10 years or so, and the ways in which it is commonly used today have much in common with the New Age's focus on tarot as a tool for self-development. While tarot is still used for divination today among some people, it is more commonly used as a psychotherapeutic device. In my own experience, the people who read the cards today are less interested in magic and more interested in learning about and bettering themselves. These 78 cards, which encompass such a wide range of human experience, can be used as a tool to facilitate inner knowledge, inner growth, and inner transformation. Their symbolism is a way to discern one's emotional states, to uncover thoughts and feelings one might be avoiding, and to create a quiet and meditative interior space. During a time when many people feel busy and pressured by the demands of modern life, tarot offers a way to slow down and look inward. The history of tarot is a history of our search for meaning. The philosophers and artists and writers of the Italian Renaissance looked for meaning in classical antiquity and Christian theology. The occultists of France and England looked for meaning in ancient cultures, which they felt sure had answers they themselves did not. The tarot readers of the New Age movement looked for meaning in themselves. Tarot has been used as a card game, a receptacle for the mysteries of the universe, a tool for divining the future, a cheaper and more accessible substitute for therapy. But while the purpose of tarot has changed, its nature has not. Tarot is a vehicle for whatever it is we seek, and that is its particular and enduring gift. 2. Why tarot? Our culture of distraction. Many of us live in a world where it's possible, even easy, to move through an entire day without a single second of quiet. We can check Twitter the moment we open our eyes in the morning, scroll through Instagram while we wait for our order at the coffee shop, listen to music during our commute, put on a podcast while we make dinner, and watch TV while we fold laundry before bed. We can pull out our phones while sitting at a red light, standing in line at a grocery store, or waiting for a friend at a bar. If there's ever a quiet minute, we always have in our hands the ability to fill it with noise. Many of these diversions with which we fill our days are designed to be addictive, stimulating us to a fever pitch so we never stop scrolling. Even those of us who want to live more intentionally often have trouble resisting this allure. But when we spend all of our time consuming vast amounts of information, we have no space to reflect on what we're taking in. We become passive consumers, always focused outward and never looking inward, compulsively resisting any moment that would leave us alone with our thoughts, in favor of the small dopamine hit of feeling plugged in. This kind of mindless passivity makes true self-reflection nearly impossible. To deeply know oneself is a holy thing. But how can we move into a deeper knowledge of the self if we're always training our focus on whatever keeps us from knowing? Each age faces its own spiritual struggles, and the environment of constant distraction in which so many of us live feels like one of the defining spiritual struggles of our time. It is bad for our minds, but it is also bad for our souls. For those of us who wish to move more deeply into relationship with God, this noisy distraction can feel like a nearly insurmountable problem. How do we fight against the impulse of constant outward movement? How do we create enough stillness to hear the voice of God? How do we pray when every moment of the day offers us a chance to distract ourselves? These questions are important because to live a life of constantly splintered concentration is to live a life in which it is extremely difficult to pray. If we are always running away from quiet, we are probably also running away from God. For better or worse, this world in which we have distraction always within arm's reach is here for good. We know that this noise isn't going away. And while we cannot change this, we can find a better way to live in it. If we are to fight against the strong current of distraction, we need spiritual disciplines that can help us regularly disengage from the constant stimulation and re-engage with a more contemplative frame of mind. We need a way to create space in our lives that will show us how to live more intentionally, with an eye towards something deeper and more nourishing. We need a tool that will help us to look at the self from which we so often run away, and to quietly sit with it. Slowing down and making space. The desire to move toward a more intentionally contemplative way of life is reflected in the tarot's renaissance in recent years. In the last decade, tarot has made a re-entry into popular culture, and it has done so in new and more expansive ways. No longer simply the domain of witches attempting to divine the future, these days tarot is as much a meditative practice as a divinatory one. To read tarot is to slow down, shuffle cards, look at images, sit in silence. Tarot demands an intentional focus in a way few things do these days, and it invites us into that focus. Tarot is able to do this in part because it's so refreshingly analog. Most of us spend hours every day looking at screens, and this focus on digital technology can cause us to neglect the role our bodies play in our experiences of life. We can lose the kind of simple tactile experiences that have the ability to slow us down and pull us out of mindless scrolling and into the bodily experience of the present moment. One of tarot's greatest and simplest strengths is that it's impossible to shuffle a deck of tarot cards and hold a phone at the same time. To interact with something so material unhurries us. It sets our minds at a gentler speed. Pulling a single card and looking at it for even 10 minutes without looking at anything else feels radical. It meets us right where we are and offers us a chance at a deeper seeing. Tarot's ability to help us slow down and take a breath is a gift. But the true magic happens when this intentionality becomes a habit. To slow down once is nice. To slow down every day will change your life. It is in the ritual that we find real change, and tarot feels tailor-made for the ritual of slowness and space-making. It has the ability to create moments when, every day, we are quieting our hearts. And when we quiet our hearts, we start to notice things we had not noticed before. Self-reflection. Today, tarot is most often used as a tool for self-reflection. When used well, it can strip away the layers of the external self, showing us what might be hiding underneath. To read tarot is to pull cards, look at the images, and ask oneself questions like, "What do I feel when I look at this image?" And, "Where do I see myself in this?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.